you glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Why don't you stand with us right now? I want to draw your attention as we start this Bible lesson time today to the book of 1 Kings. It's not on the list that I gave you guys in the back. 1 Kings chapter 17. And I want to begin reading with verse number 8. 1 Kings 17 and verse number 8. Said, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Sidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, He called her and said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand. And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel, and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks, that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die. What a sad day. It's your last meal. It's the final thing. There's nothing left after this today. But we're going to eat and die. And Elijah said unto her, listen to this, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it to me, and make for thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, until the day the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for your word today. And God, I am asking you right now to allow this word to come alive in each of us, minister to every need of this congregation, and for this we give you praise. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated, please. Oftentimes, we think about sacrifices that people make, and I am persuaded to believe that we all are called to a place of making sacrifices. If you don't make sacrifices for God and the kingdom of God, then what you're going to find out is that you're always going to be in the receiving line. I need it. I need something. Your hand is always going to be out, ready to receive something more. But it's when we make up our minds, we're going to be on the giving end of it. There's something special about giving. The one thing that preachers hate to teach on and preach on more than anything else is giving. Because immediately they think, oh, somebody thinks he wants money. No, I want you to be blessed. And there's a big difference. I want you to be blessed. And for too long, I've never said anything about giving. And I realize that as people come into the church and as people get established in the church, oftentimes they don't understand the principles behind giving. So I want to talk about giving today, but from a different viewpoint. When I read the lesson that we have here, you know, 16 of the 38 parables dealt with money. One out of every 10 verses in the Gospels deal with money and how to handle it. There are 500 verses in the Bible on prayer, 500 on faith, and 2,000 on giving. I mean, you think if it's that important of a thing that God would talk about it over and over and over again in His Word, we need to learn something about it. Because I'm going to tell you something. You're looking at a man today that's been blessed. But I've been blessed because I learned the principles of giving a long time ago. I learned the principles of giving when you didn't have it to give. I learned the principle of giving whenever you could just, all you could do was be faithful and trust God. But I was fortunate enough to be raised by mom and dad that even though they did not go to church, I was not raised going to church. We would visit a church here, we would visit a church there, we would visit somewhere else, but we were really most Sundays on the creek bank fishing. My dad did a lot of praying, fishing, Lord, help me catch that fish. And that was his, you know, that was his humor about being close to God when he was fishing. He prayed a lot. But we were real big into Boy Scouts, and we were real big into a lot of other things, but not going to church. I did not know until after I'd received the baptism of the Holy Ghost and got in church that my mom was a backslider. My mom's hair was no longer than my hair. Right now. She had short hair. I never knew my mom even knew what an apostolic church was. Until I went to a youth camp and I got the Holy Ghost and I came home and told my mom, that's the church I'm going to. My mom cried and said, okay. 3 weeks later, my mom received the Holy Ghost. I found out later my mom was a backslider from way back in her teen years and early days. But I realized that there were a lot of things that had been ground into them. And so when I would go out and do jobs at 10 years old, I would cut grass and I would come home from cutting grass and I'd put my money. My daddy said, you can't spend any of the money during the day, son. You bring it home. And so I brought it all home. He didn't take it away from me. He just wanted to teach me about money management. And so I would lay all the money on the table that I'd made. And the first thing he would say is, okay, where's God's portion? I remember looking at him and I said, God didn't cut that grass, I did. My dad didn't think that was funny one bit. He said, boy, who gave you life in your body and breath in your body and the ability to do that? He said, that first 10% belongs to God. I thank God for the principles my dad instilled in me as a child. Because once my dad got in church, church became everything for our family. We built our lives around the church. I still think the people ought to build their lives around the church. I think that we ought to build our lives around the church and around God's people because there's something special about being part of the church. We're a part of what God is doing here. And we have to understand to be part of it, we have to have ownership in this thing. Too many times we sit back and want somebody else to do it all. But God intends for us to be blessed. And so it was that I learned that principle of giving that first 10% to God. The Bible says that that first 10% is holy unto the Lord. Right. That tithe is holy. Now you go spend it if you want to, but it's going to cost you later. I promise you that. I've never seen it when it didn't. But when we put God first, here's this little lady, a widow lady that's gathering two sticks. It's interesting she said she was gathering two sticks because that's not a very big fire. Because she was acknowledging the fact, I've gotten two sticks to make a small fire and cook one small cake and we're going to die. Right. As soon as we eat that cake, that's our last meal, we're dead people. But the man of God came along. How many times has God come along in your life when it seemed like you didn't know what tomorrow held or what you were going to do tomorrow or how you were going to face it tomorrow and God came through? How many times in the scripture did it say this was happening? But God showed up. But God stepped in. But God provided. But God opened the windows of heaven. But God did these things. When Samaria was besieged and they could not eat, they had nothing left. There were 7 dove's dung soup and donkey's heads for people to eat. And there was nothing left to eat. They were starving to death. The man of God said, tomorrow about this time, God's going to come through. And one of the high and mighty said, hey, you're crazy. That can't happen. If God would make windows in heaven, that might happen. I guess he didn't understand there are windows in heaven. I began to research that this morning for just a little bit on my computer. And I began to find out that there are 9 different times it talks about there being windows in heaven. I'm thankful that there are windows in heaven and that I've got a God that knows how to raise the window and pour out a blessing on his people. He said, if there were windows in heaven, this thing might be. And the man of God turned and said, you know what? You're going to see it with your eyes, but you're not going to participate in it. And you know the rest of the story. The 4 leprous men went down to the enemy's camp in the middle of the night and just asking for a handout and something to eat, and God worked on their behalf and ran the enemy off, and they had enough food for themselves. And then they said, you know what? We don't do well if we keep this all to ourselves. Let's go tell everybody. And they went back to tell everybody. When God filled you with the Holy Ghost, He didn't do it so you could be a trophy somewhere. He filled you with the Holy Ghost so you could work for Him. He filled you with the Holy Ghost so you could do something for Him. He didn't fill you with the Holy Ghost so that you could sit on a mantelpiece and look pretty. He wanted you to win somebody for Him. He wanted you to reach out beyond yourself and do something for Him. The reason we're saved today is because His desire was to seek and save the lost. And so He put the Holy Ghost in us so that we could be a reflection of His love to other people. So when this widow lady looked like she was going to lose everything, God sends the man of God. Now I want you to understand something. The man of God had had a very lonely life for the last 3 years. He'd been down by the brook Cherith. And he'd been eating good food because the Lord sent him good food by the ravens. But he didn't have a lot of contact with people. He'd been isolated. And one day when he walked down to the brook to get something to drink, the Bible said, and his brook went dry. Sometimes in your life, you're going to find times when it looks like your brook runs dry. Your job plays out. Your savings are gone. Your car breaks down. Everything doesn't work out the way you think it ought to. And you're going to find yourself in that dry time, lonely time, broke time, frustrated time. Hear me, I'm talking to somebody here today. You've been there, you're there right now. You know what I'm talking about. And you said, I sure could use a little good news today. I can use a breath of fresh air today. I can use a little hope today. And God said to the man of God, get thee up and head down to Zarephath. I've got a widow lady down there that's going to feed you. My wife and I pastored our first church. I was only 22 and she was younger than I, and we thought we had everything together, and we went through a season where we just had nothing. We had nothing. And the house we were living in out in the country, 40 miles out in the country, got so cold at night that the water in the toilet froze. You had to pour hot water in the toilet so you could flush it in the morning. I mean, the water literally froze. It was a bad situation. And I remember that we had to take a break from there and come into town, and there was a widow lady. And every time I read this story, I don't know, I see old Sister Downing. She was about as big around as she was tall. And but I'm telling you, that little lady could cook. Lord have mercy, could she cook. And she loved to cook. And my wife and I loved her cooking. And so we would stay with her. And there was something about being at her house that just brought such a love and a warmth there that we just felt safe. I got a feeling that when the man of God got down to this widow's place and he told her, he said, now there's going to be enough food. You're not going to have to worry. She had a choice to make whether she wanted to believe God, the man of God, or believe her circumstances. She either had to believe the man of God or to believe her circumstances. You know what? There's always going to be three voices that you will hear in your head whenever you think about giving. When you think about whatever it is you're going to do, there's three voices that are crying out. There's the crying out voice of need. I need to pay this. I need to do this. I need to do this. I need to do this. And then there's that voice that you'll hear crying out of greed. Well, you know what? I need to get a little head. I got to put this back. I got to save this. I got to have this. I need this. I need. I need it. I won't. I won't. I won't. Right. Then that third voice is that voice of need. And that is, instead of, or seed. The voice of seed says, I need to plant a seed. I need to plant a seed. How many of you like fruit? Anybody here like peaches? Anybody here ever had Georgia peaches? I'll tell you. South Carolina peaches are really better than Georgia peaches, but now I'll get run out of the state even though I was born and raised in Georgia. If you ever get over to Johnson, South Carolina, the best peaches in the world come from that place. I don't know what's in the soil there, but I promise you, those are the best peaches in the world. And I remember getting one of those peaches, or some of those peaches. I never had one. It's always some with me. And eating those, and I said, I want to plant the seed out of this peach in the ground. Now, when I was a kid, I remember telling my dad one time, Dad, this is so good. This peach is so good. I wish there wasn't a seed in it and I could just eat the whole thing. And one time I was sucking on the peach seed. My daddy said, what are you doing? I said, I've already eaten the peach and I'm trying to see if there's any more goody left of the seed. He said, son, that won't work. But I realized that when God created the world, he placed the seed inside of the fruit so that we could grow again something more. The same principle is true in our giving. When we understand seed giving, that God said that he would supply seed for the sower. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning with verse number 6, read for me, Brother Amy.
But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly.
Wait a minute. There's a principle right there. If it don't go any further, if you get that, you'll understand it all. He that sows sparingly, sows just means plants sparingly, gives sparingly. He's going to reap sparingly. Some of you don't realize the blessings that God gives you because you don't know what it is to sow a seed and say, hey God, I want to give. I want to give more. I want to give by faith. I want to be one of those people. He said that he that soweth sparingly shall reap sparingly, reap.
And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully.
Keep reading.
Every man according as he purpose in his heart.
Here we go. Now there's the key right there. You got a purpose in your heart. You have to purpose in your heart. You have to purpose in your heart. What are you going to give? I don't think it ought to be a time when the offering plate comes by and you say, okay, let me see if I got any money. I think that Dave Ramsey says, you know what, you put a name on every dollar before you get it. I like that philosophy. It's not Bible, but I like that philosophy. It's biblical in principle. And so Dave would say, you know, put a name on every dollar. Sometimes we sit down and say, okay, God, this is what we have. What would you have us give? Now, we know what our tithe is going to be, but what would you have us give? See, offering is something you give above your tithe. And when you sit down and say, hey, God, I want to sow a seed. There are some people, and we're going to have a testimony service here in a short time, not today, but we're going to have one. I want some people to give some testimonies of what sowing seed has done in their lives because I want to build your faith. Because I want you to be blessed. He said, you got a purpose in your heart what you're going to give. Read.
So let him give not grudgingly or of necessity. For God loveth a cheerful giver.
God loves a cheerful giver. Keep reading.
And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work.
God wants you to have plenty. I'm not preaching a prosperity message today. I'm just teaching you God wants to bless his children.
Hallelujah.
He wants you to have. He does not want you to be without. God wants to bless his children. He knows how to give good gifts to his children. And he said, but don't do it grudgingly. I remember old brother CLDs in Texas tell the story about Reggie, his son, in the middle of a 300-400 people in service, and the offering time came, and Reggie was sitting about halfway back in the center, and the offering plate came down his way. He took a dollar bill out very dramatically, kissed that dollar, put it in the offering plate. No, Brother Dees was sitting on the platform. He jumped up, grabbed the microphone, and he said, stop the music! Well, they stopped. He told the usher, he said, you, take that offering plate and get Reggie's dollar out of it and give it back to him. Boy, if you love it that much, you keep it. God don't want it. Now, open rebuke is better than secret love. If y'all were raised around my mother-in-law, you would have found out she did a few things like that every once in a while too. You know, it's just all of a sudden, it's like, hey, wait a minute. Made a point. I talked to Reggie one time after that. He said, I've never kissed another bill in my life. He said, man, I just bountifully gave with joy, wanted to shout just about every time I put it in. He said, my dad broke me from that. But if we understand that we ought to do it with joy. We ought to do it with joy. When it's offering time, we ought to be excited because we get to give. I've been in the place where I was so broke, I didn't have anything to give. But I thank God that God has blessed his children. And we are blessed people. I look in the parking lot and they're nice cars in the parking lot. And if you're driving something that's not nice, you're thankful you got something to drive. And walking's free and it's not crowded. But boy, it sure beats having something to drive. But I'm asking us today, are we a cheerful giver? He said the Lord loves a cheerful giver, that he might be able to give you sufficiency in all things. We know.
As it is written, he has dispersed abroad and he has given to the poor. His righteousness remaineth forever.
How many of you are living in a better house today than the house you were born in? Okay. How many of you are driving a nicer car than the one you grew up in? Aren't we blessed people? You know, we sit around and talk about what we don't have. We need to start looking about what we do have. I mean, we didn't have an air conditioner in my home until I was in the 11th grade. Then we got a little window unit air conditioner, sat in one room. And we used to go and sit in front of it and take turns. And every 30 minutes, my brother would slap me out of the chair. It was his turn to sit there for 30 minutes. You know, you'd have thought we were just worshiping this air conditioner. I mean, we'd never seen it before. Just a blizzard and I dated in a 65 Chevrolet carry-all van with no air conditioner. Well, it did. It had 260 miles, two windows down, 60 miles an hour. That was the air conditioner. And that's what we dated in. She didn't say, hey, my folks have got this nice air-conditioned car. You know, when you get something nice to carry me around in, I wouldn't have dated her. I know that's shocking to you. But if she was too good for me, that wouldn't have worked for us. She didn't, you know, I know how to abound, know how to be abased. I know how to have everything and have nothing. Until you can learn to be flexible and faithful during all of those times, you've got a lot to learn. Until you can learn to be happy in whatever state you're in and be content and be faithful when you're going through the break. Because there's going to be breaking times in everybody's life. You need to understand that. But if you can be faithful and know that God is faithful, he said that he blesses the poor. He gives to the poor. Now read verse 10. This is where the key of this comes in.
Now he that ministereth deed to the sower, both minister bread for your food.
Read.
And multiply your seed sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. Being enriched in everything to all bountifulness, which causeth through us thanksgiving to God.
Now understand, when God blesses, he doesn't add to whatever it was that you did. God multiplies. God multiplies. I read with interest just a few weeks ago. I was doing some research on something. I read with interest about the pilgrims. I guess it's been several weeks ago. It was back at Thanksgiving time. In the beginning of our country, 58 pilgrims got together. And they realized that they were going to starve to death if they didn't do something. And so they set aside a 21-acre tract of ground for a garden. And they cleared it all out, cleared all the stuff out of it. And on one given day, they took a day of fasting. Now what they fasted that day, each one of them got a ration every day of 6 kernels of corn. That's all they got for the day. 6 kernels of corn. That's not even a tablespoon. That's barely a teaspoon. How How did they live? They ate fruits and vegetables. They ate fruits and stuff like that, but that's what they got. But on this particular day, they decided to fast and pray. And each of them contributed their six little kernels of corn for the day to that garden. A year later, they had the first Thanksgiving feast with plenty of food. But what happened? Those six little kernels of corn that each one of them gave produced a whole garden full that everybody can eat off of.
Yeah, right.
See, when you put a seed into the ground, and you put a peach seed into the ground, and you cultivate it, and you water it, you take care of it, you watch it grow, it's going to produce a whole tree full of peaches.
Yeah, right.
But sometimes it takes a while to do that. You see, I was going to plant tomatoes one time. I planted them. Went out the next day and there was no tomatoes on there. I said, man, that's crazy. My brother-in-law said to me, he's the one that gave me the tomato plants. He said, how's your tomato plants doing? I said, I don't have any tomatoes. He said, well, you don't get tomatoes right away. He said, do you have any blooms on? I got blooms on mine. I said, no, man, they look like they're dying. He said, have you watered them? I said, water them. I'm not a farmer. He said, you got to water them. So I nearly drowned them trying to water them. I didn't know anything about it. I just tried, man. My brother-in-law came over and he said, you're stupid. You know that? I said, thanks a lot. Makes me feel good. He says, what you got to do? And so he began to work with them and he got some miracle growing. And he got all kinds of stuff. And he would come by my house to be sure I was doing it right. What happened was those tomato plants started to grow up the fence and he would tie them off. And then blooms came. They didn't come as fast as he is because he knew what to do. I didn't know what to do. But then tomatoes came. And I think I still love tomatoes because of those tomatoes, because I grew them. Matter of fact, the other day I told my wife, I said, I am having a southern fit. She said, what? I said, a tomato sandwich. You never had one of those. You ought to try it. Get you a real sweet tomato. Get you a slice about that thick of that tomato. Get you some light bread and get you some Miracle Whip, a little salt and pepper. Whop that thing together. And I'm telling you what, that's eating right there. You never had, some of y'all want to go home and try that today. You get that and a whole pot of stewed tomatoes and you got a southern meal that just lasts you for a while. But when you understand it's those simple things, those little things that if you sow the seed, you're going to get a bigger return. God does not add to, He multiplies. He multiplies your giving. He multiplies the seed that you sow. You got to find the good ground that you want to sow in. But I'm going to tell you, there's some principle about sowing and supply that God will not. If you eat all the seed, you're going to starve to death.
Yeah.
You need to understand that. You're going to starve to death. But we know when you sow those seed, you connect yourself with God and His supply. And God, I'm sowing this seed by faith. And I'm believing, God, you're going to supply all of my needs according to your riches and glory. I said to Sister Blizzard and I were talking a couple of weeks ago, and I said to her, we've been saving up to buy a bed. The one we've had is probably, 12 years old? Is that about right? 10, 12, I don't know. And she's been wanting this bed that kind of lifts up and does all this stuff because she has a herniated disc in her back. And so we were trying in our old age to save up and get this really nice Sleep Number deal. And I don't have to tell you, those are expensive. And we had saved up enough to get it. And then we decided to buy this church building and to try to get the building. And so I looked at her and I said, we can't ask somebody else to do what we're not doing. Do you want to, you feel like we need to give the money we saved for that? And she said, yeah. So we got a $10,000 check for the building fund to go. And the day after we made that commitment, I got $1,700 from somewhere I didn't expect it. Now, I'm not going to tell you it's going to always happen that way. But 3 days later, I got $250, and I told my wife, I said, hey, we're over $2,000 here. Where did this come from? And I'm talking about it came from somewhere that I never dreamed it'd come from. And I realized that, wait a minute, God keeps good score. And that's all within 3 or 4 days of what God did. And I thought, why? You know, sometimes you'll wait 10 years for God to give you a return on your money. But let me tell you something. God keeps good books. I want you to hear me. God keeps good books. Because even if it is 10 years, when God does come through, He'll blow your mind. I've had Him do that to me, and I'm just sitting there and say, God, I don't know how you did this, but I sure am glad you did. And God, more than that, I'm glad that somewhere I sowed a seed. When you read Malachi chapter 3 and in verse number 9 or verse number 8, the Bible said, will a man rob God? See, you said, ye have robbed me, but you say, wherein have we robbed thee? He said, in tithes and offerings. Then he goes in verse 9, he says, you are cursed with a curse, for you've robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me. He said, try me now wherewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing there's not room to contain. Do you have enough guts sometimes to try God, to prove Him? You see, if He really meant what He said, I got news for you. God really meant what He said. He said, try me and see. And somewhere, if you learn to try God, what you're going to understand is that God made a promise He's going to bless you. You see, God's heart is moved by need, but His hand is moved by seed. When you sow a seed, it moves God's hand to have to do something. It moves God's hand to have to do something. God gets involved because you've made a commitment, and God in that commitment starts to do something. Sowing seed guarantees the harvest, but what you've got to do is figure out how big of a harvest you want. Because the size of your sowing determines the size of the harvest. Last February, we were getting ready to do a quiz thing, and Brother Hernandez is not here to defend himself, so I'm going to tell it anyway. He was trying to sell a house down in California, and he wasn't having any success, and nothing was going good, and we were praying about it. And so it came time that we were getting ready to send our quiz team somewhere, and I remember putting my arm around him, and I said, he said, bro, we want to help at the cost of sending the quiz team. I said, Brother Hernandez, you're doing all you can do right now. The church is going to pick this up. And we're gonna take care of the cost of the quiz team going. And I saw him with an envelope with $100 in it. And he said, I want to sow a seed into our quiz team. And he put that $100 in there. And I don't remember whether it was the next day or the day after that, my phone rings and he says, hey, the house is sold. And I said, okay. You see, you sow a seed. And that $100 seed was not the size of the return he got. He sold the house. He needed to sell the house. And God blessed him to be able to do it. There's something amazing when you sow seeds. You know, you never know what blessing is just on the other side of your obedience. That woman that was gathering 2 sticks to make 1 little thing of bread so they could die never realized that meal barrel was not going to run dry because she obeyed what God had said to do. I'm trying to tell us as a church, if we will obey God, God will do the work. If we will obey God, even when it sounds crazy, if we'll obey God. If we will trust Him, God will open the windows of heaven. That widow woman had the opportunity set before her. She had to choose what she was going to do with it. It was like the new convert I heard about, that he got saved and he was a farmer and he raised pigs. And he told the pastor the night after he got saved, he said, oh, pastor, if I had 100 pigs, I'd give God 50 of them. He said, Charlie, that's great. He said, no, I mean it. If I had 20 pigs, I'd give God 10 of them. He said, Charlie, if you had 2 pigs, would you give God 1 of them? He said, now, pastor, that ain't fair. You know I got 2 pigs. how it all changed, didn't it? It all changed. Another farmer said, they were asking him how he was always able to give. And he said, well, I don't know. He said, I've just always been a giver. And he said, here's what I learned as a young man. He said, and he was out by his grain, he started shelling grain and throwing it to the people. He said, I figured if I shovel grain into God's bin this way, God shovels grain into my bin. And the difference is God's got a bigger shovel. I want to tell somebody today, God's got a bigger shovel. When you learn to just step out by faith, and many of you have stepped out by faith in our building program and what we're trying to do to buy a lot and then to buy a building, and I'll give you an update on that in a little bit on what's going on with that. But some of you have stepped out by faith and said, you know what, I want to be part of this. I want to give. And some of you have given sacrificially. And I know that God keeps good score. As a matter of fact, I've been taking some notes on just, and my mind is blown by what I see, what people are doing by faith and giving. Because the Bible said that he would bless you, give you, he would pour out a blessing there's not room enough to contain. But then he said, I will rebuke the devourer for your sins. And he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before her time, saith the Lord of hosts. And all nations shall call you blessed. I want everybody in town to know how blessed Praise Tabernacle is. I really do. I want everybody in town to know how blessed we are right here. But that's going to come whenever you learn the secret of sacrificial giving. As we all learn it, this is an area that I've stayed away from for the last 23 years. Because I figured, you know what, if you wanted to give, you just give. And God's been challenging me. When David got ready and it came time to build the temple, he made a statement in 1 Chronicles 29. Start reading verse 1 for me, please, quickly.
Furthermore, David the king said unto all the congregation, Solomon, my son, whom alone God has chosen.
He said, God chose this young man.
He's yet young and tender, and the work is great.
He said, building this place, building this palace or this temple is not for a man, but it's for the Lord God. Now, this is going to be a big job for him. Listen to what he said.
Now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God, the gold for things to be made of gold, and the silver for things to be made of silver, and the brass for things to be made of brass, the iron for iron, wood for things of wood, onyx stones and stones to be set, glistering stones and of divers colors, and all manner of precious stones and marble, stones in abundance, moreover, because I have set my affection to the house of my God, I have of my own proper good of gold and silver, which I have given to the house of my God, over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house.
Did you notice what he's done here? He took ownership of that. He said, it's my God. It's my God's house we're building. He said, I took my gold and my silver and I put it in my God's place. There's something about it. He said, I have set my affection to the house of my God. I want us to set our affection to the house of God. I want us to understand. He said, I prepared with all of my might that I might be able to give. There's something about it. As a man purposes in his heart, so let him give. Mark would say, for what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And what will a man give in exchange for his soul? There's something special whenever we say, I want to give it to my God and the house of God and the things of God. Matthew would write 6:19, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where the moth doth and rust doth corrupt, but where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves don't steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where your treasure is. I'm asking you today, where's your treasure today? Where's your treasure today? Where is it that you want to see God bless? Where is it that you made up your mind? There's two important rules of giving that I want you to understand. Rule number one is if you sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. But he that sows abundantly shall reap abundantly. You know, with that same measure that you meet, it's going to be measured back to you. We control it. We control the nozzle. We control the valve of how we want it to pour out. Keep your motive pure. You don't give so you get something back. This is not the stock market. I said, this is not the stock market. Oh, I've had people tell me that. I have one lady that sends a check. She sent one to me the other day, and she said, I want you to anoint this and pray for a hundredfold return. I prayed for a hundredfold return. It was good seed. But she will tell you that she has sown into Praise Tabernacle through the years. She doesn't even live here. She's sown into Praise Tabernacle through the years, and God's always, she said, given a great return on every seed she sowed. I have two businessmen here in town that don't come to the church, but yet they sowed seed in Praise Tabernacle. One gave $2,000 twice in the last couple of months because he said, I want to sow some good seed because God gives a return. I believe that God can talk to people outside the church and have them give, but I believe that God also wants to bless the people in the church, and we can't sit back and wait for somebody else to do it. Brother Hernandez said the other day, We have a millionaire right now that's talking about blessing the church, and he is saying that he could pay for the new church and the new property and build a new church. And I was telling Brother Hernandez about it, and he said, oh, Pastor, be careful what you say there. I don't want some millionaire stealing my blessing. I want to pound in that thing. I want to invest in that thing. And in it, God does something there, that's okay. But let me have something in it first. David said when it came time to offer the sacrifice, they were bringing the Ark of the Covenant back home. They stopped at Aranoth's vineyard, and there they bought a place, and Aranoth said to him, said, I'll just give it to you. And David said, No. I'll not offer anything to my God that didn't cost me something. He said, thank you for the offer. He said, but I'm not going to offer anything that didn't cost me something. You see, when you got a pound of flesh in the game, when you got something in the game that says, hey, God, I put up and I shut up and I waited on you. Then when God opens the windows of heaven and God does bless you, you realize where it came from. Because see, I think God wants to bless his people. I said, I believe that God wants to bless his people. And I believe God's going to bless his people. I got a feeling there's some blessings coming for some people that have learned the rule, the secret. And the second rule is, as every man purposes in his heart, let him give not grudgingly, but a cheerful giver. Now I wonder how IRS would survive like that. You know? When you understand that God can bless you because he wants to bless the sower. Those that put that seed into the ground. That little widow lady, I wonder how many times they sat around the fire at night. It was like she had another, when the prophet came, the man of God came, God brought blessings into the house and peace into the house. The Shunammite woman did the same thing. She built a little room on the wall. But I wonder what it must have been like just sitting around and having dinner. Now they had food to eat. And they were never going hungry. And then they talked about the blessings of God. I wonder what it was like whenever he told her about being by the brook Kidroth and how that the ravens would come in and feed it. And that young boy, the son that she had there, would listen to the man of God tell those stories about how God supplied. I'm telling you today, if God has met a need in your life and you've got a testimony about it, you need to share that testimony. You need to say, hey, wait a minute. I went through a time and God came through. When I couldn't do anything, God showed up and God came through. If you have one of those testimonies, I want you to either let me know after service today or write it down or email it or something and let me know. And we're going to have a time of sharing because I want to build people's faith. I think we're at a place right now in a crossroads where God wants to bless his children in a special way. But I believe he wants to build our faith to be able to do it. And I think he's going to do it from the body. I believe he's going to do it from the body. And God's going to be in need. Let's stand together. Dear Jesus, thank you for your word today. And And God, these wonderful people that have come to hear it, I just delivered exactly what I felt like you gave me. And God, let this seed of the word find fallow ground that's been broken up in people's hearts. And God, increase our faith and meet our needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.